Let me stress from the very beginning that I'm neither a legal scholar nor an expert on the region, for that matter. Actually, my thoughts, my ideas, and my books, and my writings were not so much a response to what was happening in Bosnia, but they were a response to what I considered a profound political immaturity in my own country. So it was, it's the, my writings were more addressed on the issue of what, where is my country, what is the identity of my country, and what, of course, triggered my critique was, of course, the events in Bosnia. The defining characteristic of the Greek approach, of the Greek state and society's approach towards the war in Bosnia was something beyond self-denial, something beyond denial. It was simply a very simple fact of not wanting to face concrete events, but instead reverting into myths and history. People were not looking at what happened in Foča. When you presented them with the argument, what is happening in Foča, they would reply, but you forget what the Ustasha did during the Second War. When you presented with the argument, look what's happening in Sarajevo, the answer would be, yes, but you forget what the Turks are doing in Cyprus. When you talked about Zvornik, the answer would be again, oh, but you really forget the brave Serb guerrillas who fought against the Germans. So in all instances, the dominant discourse was one of not looking at concrete events and dissolving the concrete into abstract, super abstract concepts. Hegel would have a great time in Greece. Throughout the war in Bosnia, not a single Greek mainstream politician, not a single Greek political party, a business leader, or a trade unionist had the courage, the will, or the inclination to condemn Serb crimes in Foče, Zvornik, Sarajevo, and finally Srebrenica, and of course elsewhere. Whenever the issue of those crimes was raised, the answer was that either that was fabricated and that in the last analysis the fault lay with the West, with the Muslims, with the Catholics, with the machination of NATO, with everybody else, but the actual people who committed those crimes. I will concentrate in a telegraphic fashion on three, 4 points which I consider the highlights of this, I would call it, paranoid situation that existed and still exists in Greece, although now it's subdued. Simply people do not talk about it. They have forgotten everything about it. It's not that they changed their minds. The four issues I want to simply mention would be, one is the attitude of the Greek church, the attitude of the Greek left, those two are combined. The Karadzic cult that developed in Greece during those years, the attitude of Greece to the deliberations of the ICTI, and finally, the famous issue of the Greek paramilitaries in Srebrenica and the raising of the Greek flag in Srebrenica. Starting with the Greek church, from the very beginning of the conflict, the Greek church asserted through the voice of its archbishop, that Greece, under all circumstances, will side with our Serb brethren because we are Orthodox people. And Orthodox people have to stand together. The issue of deciding with whom we stand on the basis of human rights issues never crossed the mind of the Greek Church. We had to be with the Serbs. And mind you, here what is interesting and what is not very much mentioned is that the solidarity of the Orthodox Church with the Serb war effort did not restrict itself to proclamations, etc. What is very interesting is that many Greek priests traveled regularly to war-ravaged Bosnia to provide spiritual succor to the Bosnian Serb army and to conduct church services with Serb priests in the presence of Serb officers. They also visited Serb army barracks, prayed with the soldiers for final victory, and posed with them for pictures that were widely distributed in Serbia. The highlights of this thing was in 1993 in December, where Greek priests went and conducted liturgy together with Serb priests at the Church of St. Nicholas in Zvornik. 1 year before, the city had been cleansed of its Muslim population. The dominant narrative of the church concerning the conflict in Bosnia was that here we had a fight of the Vatican and all the other international forces of evil against the Orthodox people. Interestingly enough, this kind of narrative, with some slight variations, but the essence was the same, was also the narrative of the Greek left, especially of the Socialist Party and George Papandreou. Andreas Papandreou. In the same way, they saw also the conflict as one that was originating with the Vatican in Germany, and some were also America, and they saw Karadzic, Mladic, etc., as the heroes of the international resistance against world capitalism. This story is quite funny, apart from the tragic. The funny thing was that when Karadzic was coming to Greece, he was always visiting Papandreou, and Papandreou used to call him comrade. And one day, Karadzic turned around to his interpreter and asked him, "Why does he call me comrade? Does he think I'm a communist?" So that was the thing. Now, Karadzic, during those days, what developed in Greece was a true Karadzic cult. Karadzic was met in Greece like a rock star. He would appear everywhere, television shows, etc. And all the business and political elites would rush to see him and would be doing everything they could to have an interview with him. In 1990, I will read you a piece, a report, the way Karadzic's visits were reported in Greece, where you can see the feeling of exaltation which existed for him. "Passers-by taking their stroll this warm summer night," read a typical newspaper report of Karadzic outings in Greece, "would stop to shake hands with the Serb leader. The fact that they could not speak his language didn't seem to matter. The warm handshake, the expression in their eyes, were enough to express their solidarity." And of course, Karadzic reciprocated. And the most famous speech, and also extremely significant, was in 1993 in an open football stadium, where in the presence of the Greek archbishop, in the presence of members of parliament from all political parties, communists, right-wing, liberals, etc., he uttered the famous words under the thunderous applause of the crowd. He said, "Everybody's telling us to lay down our arms because we are alone. We say no, we are not alone. We have with us God and the Greeks." Now, I don't know about God, but the interesting thing here is that no Greek politician protested about the fact that Karadzic asserted openly that the Greeks were not asking him to lay down his arms. What he, in effect, he asserted was that the Greeks were telling him to continue with the armed struggle. And this goes very much against the dominant Greek propaganda, which at the time was that we are trying to play a peacemaking role. We are being friends with everybody so we can facilitate a compromise and a truce. Actually, if it wasn't tragic, it would be extremely hilarious. When Karadzic came to Athens for this meeting, first he met Archbishop of Greece, Seraphim, and when the Archbishop said, when Karadzic tried to kiss the hand of the Archbishop replied to Karadzic, "No, it's me who should kiss your feet." He wasn't the only one. One of our greatest ship owners, Mr. Vardinogiannis, went to his hotel room, fell on his knees, and said, "My general, I would give all my ships to have only one moment of your glory." When the indictment by the ICTA came out against Karadzic and Mladic, within 3 days, 2 million signatures were collected asking the Serb government never to hand over Karadzic and Mladic to the war tribunal. Which brings me to the attitude, to the approach, to the deliberation of the War Crimes Tribunal. From the very beginning, the attitude was dismissive. It went through 3 stages. The first stage of the Greek response was the argument that the conflict in Bosnia cannot be solved by legalistic means, and having courts interfere with what was going on is going to make the situation worse. That was the first argument. When this argument didn't fail, they reverted to the second argument. And the second argument was, why should they arrest Karadzic? Everybody has committed crimes. Why Karadzic? Why not everybody? So we should wait for everybody to be arrested and then they should arrest Karadzic. And the third argument was simply, after some time, it was simply silence. And, you know, neither for nor against, etc. Which brings me to the final issue, all these issues I touched very telegraphically. I could go on for hours about Greek support to the war and how the Greek behavior, etc. The fourth issue is the issue of the Greek volunteers or paramilitaries in Srebrenica. Thank you. It has been, what is very interesting was that there was this fighting force and that they raised the Greek flag, and that the Greek flag after instruction by General Mladic. And this issue was presented by the Greek television stations and by the Greek press as a triumph. The event was headlined as the fall of Srebrenica and our braves being there together with the Serbs, with their Serb brothers. To give you the idea of the kind of reports, talking about the flags, one major newspaper wrote, "They are flying side by side, a living proof of the love and solidarity of the two peoples and of the gratitude which the Serb soldiers feel for the help from the Greek volunteers who are fighting on their sides." When the newspaper ran a two-page spread about the heroic exploits in Srebrenica and elsewhere in August 1995, the popular response was overwhelming. "Our telephone lines," wrote an editor the next day, "were constantly busy from the calls of scores of youth who were asking for information concerning how to join the force that was fighting together with the Serbs." Some of us tried repeatedly to press the Greek government to arrest the people, not necessarily because they had committed crimes, because we don't know what they had done, but simply to ask them what they were doing in Srebrenica, what they were doing in Bosnia, so as to collect information which would help the War Crime Tribunal. Finally, we had to sue the government, and an investigation started. And I was the chief witness. I was asked to testify. So I went there, and the investigating judge asked me what I had, and I gave them the names. I gave it's Bob, George, etc. And then the question of the judge was, "Do you have their addresses?" And I said, "No, I don't have their addresses. I have their names." And she said, "And how do you expect me to find them?" After 2 days, the investigation was over. In 2005, 100 Greek intellectuals and journalists and others signed a petition asking the Greek government to apologize to the government and the people of Bosnia for the despicable position they had taken up during the war. We are still waiting for an answer. Thank you.